a few people might join us as we go, but our normal course coordinator, Margaret Graham, is taking a little bit of a break this week. She's somewhere in Europe and doesn't have access to internet. So I'm going to have the pleasure of introducing our speaker today, Ron Ji from Nanjing University. And just to give you a little bit of background on Ron, he did his undergraduate and master's degrees at the University of Qingdao in China, and then did his PhD at the University of Constance in Germany. He also did postdoctoral programs at the Aachen University Institute for Environmental Research and at the Max Planck Institute for Terrestrial Microbiology. Since 2006, Rong has been a professor at Nanjing University in the School of Environment. And he is also an adjunct professor in the Institute for Marine Science at the university. And since 2015, has been the associate director of the National Engineering Research Center for Organic Pollution Control and Resource Reuse of China. So with that, we'll turn it over to you, Ron, and look forward to your talk.
Okay. Thank you, Doc, for the nice introduction. So as you see in the PowerPoint, today my topic is the earthworm-enhanced remediation of soil with organic contaminants. So I will talk to you in three parts. The first part is about some theory, and then there is some lab results, and finally the field in situ bioremediation using earthworm. So the theory. So let me see the contamination, organic contamination. I have to see my PowerPoint. So is a, organic pollutants in the soil. What kind of process do they have when they enter the soil? So here is a summarize of the pollutants process in the soil. We see here they may be volatilized to the air. It may be soft to soil component. Here can be soft in the clay minerals, can be soft to soil organic matter, and it can be degraded by microorganisms, can also be degraded by plants, for example. It can be transformed into the groundwater, can be transformed into the plants, this bioaccumulation. And these are the processes that pollutants may be subject in the soil environment. So here, so we see some of the process affect the mobility of the pollutants. Some of the process affect the persistence of pollutants. So here you see here the degradation transformation will affect the persistence. All these processes will have an impact on the toxicity and effects of the pollutants in the environment. So what kind of factors is determined for the pollutants persistent in the soil? This depends on several processes. So this is, first thing is the amount and the type of the pollutants. So this is chemically, for example, what kind of pollutants is it is soluble or the not soluble, is aromatic or the aliphatic. This kind of chemical structure is very important for the degradation, for the degradation potential of the pollutants. And the second one is the presence of the degraders. That means if there is any organisms who can degrade the pollutants. If there's no degraders in the soil, for example, then the pollutant is always persistent. So then another factor is the accessibility of the pollutant to the degraders. So if they are degraders in the soil, but they are not accessible to the pollutants, then in this case, these pollutants are also very stable. So this environment analysis, the fourth fact determines is the environmental conditions. This environmental condition including, for example, soil pH, soil temperature, the humidity, the soil aeration, and the nutrients level in the soil. All this could be very important for the degradation of the pollutants. So when we talk about the remediation of soil, that means we want to purify and revitalize the soil quality. And this means we should degrade the pollutants. And there are several approaches to do the remediation of the soil, including the physical remediation, chemical remediation, and biological remediation. Physically, the soil pollutants can be volatilized or washed, and also with other methods. And chemically, these pollutants can be oxidized or reduced to non-toxic compounds. And biologically, biological remediation means we use organisms to remediate the soil. These organisms could be microorganisms, plants, and animals. So this is bioremediation. And this organism could be naturally, organisms could also be genetically modified organisms, the GMOs. And this bioremediation could be in situ, done, could be also ex situ performed. And the most important thing for the bioremediation of soil is to enhance the bioremediation efficiency. And the question is how to enhance the bioremediation efficiency. Okay. So there are several approaches, at least the two. The first one is stimulation and the second one is bioaccumulation. So let me introduce you what is the biostimulation. So in the soil, we have the pollutants here, we have degraders here, we have our nutrients. So the biostimulation means that we stimulate the activity of the organisms that are already persistent in the soil to perform the degradation, to degrade the pollutants to non-toxic products, the non-toxic products here. And usually, we put nutrients and also other electron acceptors to finish to do this biostimulation. The electron acceptor could be, for example, oxygen, could be also nitrate compound. This biostimulation means we stimulate the activity of the microorganisms not already present in the soil, this indigenous organism in the soil. And another one is the bioaugmentation. The bioaugmentation means that the organism that's present in the soil is not capable of doing the degradation process. And in this case, we put new organisms. For example, here we put the new organisms into the soil, and these organisms can do the degradation. So this means the bioaugmentation. Normally, when people do the bioaugmentation, they added also nutrients together with the organisms to the soil. Except this bioaugmentation and the biostimulation, we also talk the photoremediation when we phytoremediation when we do the remediation process. Phytoremediation means use plants to remediate the soil, and this phytoremediation could include the first four different kind of remediation. The first one is phytovolatilization, the second phytoextraction, and there's phytodegradation, and then phytostabilization. That means use the plants to volatilize, to extract, and to degrade and stabilize pollutants in the soil. And here is some scheme about the phytoremediation, but now I don't want to to it detail in my lecture, I think Professor Ma will give you more details about phytoremediation. In addition to the microorganisms, plants in the soil, we have also many animals. This means the soil fauna. Here is a picture about some typical soil fauna. So they could be very small. For example, it's a protozoa, nematodes. It could be also larger. Looks like, for example, the mites, yeah, and also wood lice, red ant, and they could be also larger. So, for example, it's earthworms and also moles. They are all living in the soil. They are all the soil fauna. The small soil fauna, smaller than 100 micrometer, we call this a microfauna. And it's from 100 micrometer to 2 millimeter, and they are mesofauna. So they are here, for example, mites, they are mesofauna. And the other faunas which has a size more than 2 millimeter, and we call this macrofauna. So earthworm is a typical macrofauna in the soil. And this is also quite the topic of my talk. So in soil, we have many organisms. When we look at the distribution of the biomass in the soil of the different organisms, we look here, this is a figure here to show the biomass of different organisms in soil. So we have here, this is a bacteria, actinomycetes. They account for 40% of the soil organisms. And then another 40% is a fungi and algae. And then others is earthworm, soil fauna. So here is a micro and mesofauna account for 3% of the total soil organisms. And the meso, the other macrofauna is 5%, and the earthworms account for 12% of the soil biomass. So here we see the soil fauna, earthworm is the account for the majority. And the role of the earthworm in the soil has been described 2000 years ago, 2400 years ago by Aristotle. He said, as earthworms are the intestines of the earth. So it's a very important part of the earth. And then in the 130 years ago, Charles Darwin wrote one paper. He's the first person who investigated the role of earthworm in the soil. The paper is the formation of vegetable mound through the action of worms. The worm is here the earthworm. So this is already, that means the earthworms played a very important role in the soil, and it has been recognized many years ago. So here, let me see the community of the macrofauna in the soil. Here is, we see the a picture describing the biomass, total biomass, total the macrofauna biomass, and also the distribution of the macrofauna in different types. So we see here the larger of the circles, the more biomass. So here we see, here is the annual crop, which is the biomass of the macrofauna, not so high, but in the pastures, the biomass is very large. And we see here most of the macrofauna in the soil is this one with many, many dots. And this one is the earthworms, is the fauna earthworms. So we see here in the five different soils, the earthworms account almost always the largest part of the macrofauna. So when earthworm present in soil, the earthworm has great impact on the soil community and the soil properties and the soil chemical, physical, and biological properties. And here is a short description, what kind of impacts of the soil, of the earthworms on the soil. So when earthworm into the soil, earthworms have the boring or the movement in the soil, and they create a burrow, and they ingest, digest, and excrete the soil, and then they form soil cast. This is a feeding, total feeding activity of the earthworms. So when, let me look, the first one, the boring, the movement. So the boring movement has impact on the soil structure. It's they improve the soil structure, and they increase the soil porosity, and they improve the aggregation, the soil aggregation, and also they improve the organic matter turnover in the soil. And therefore they improve the fertility of the soil. And also it's very important, this spurring and the movement will promote the activity of the microorganism in soil. And also they will improve the dispersity of the microorganisms in the soil. So the distribution of the microorganisms in soil. And the boric creation has impact on soil. They improve the oxygen and the gas diffusion in the soil. They improve the drainage and the dispersity of the moisture in the soil. And they improve the nutrient movement in the soil. And also they improve the soil microorganism activity and also the distribution of the microorganism in soil. So the action of the ingestion, digestion, and excretion of soil, they can break down of the soil particles. The large particles will be broken into small particles, and then the organic residues will be released to the soil environment, and they become bioavailable to microorganisms. And then this soil injection, digestion, and extraction process can also dispose and transport microorganisms in the soil. And also this process can enhance the organic matter turnover. And this could be an addition of the high energy compound to the soil. And because most of the degradation products are water soluble. And also this activity will increase the microorganism activity and also the distribution in the soil. In the formation of the cast is the soil particles become smaller, and therefore the surface area of the soil increase. And this could increase the water holding capacity of the soil. And on the cast and the constant, the organic matter sorption of the organic matter could be high. And therefore, here the organic matter content could be also higher than the normal soil. And also here, the nutrient content and the availability in the cast is enhanced compared to the normal soil. And here is normally in the cast, the CN ratio is higher. And normally also the cast has a higher pH than the non-treated soil. And also the microorganism has a higher activity in the earthworm cast. So all of this, the earthworm action, and the earthworm effects on the soil, physical, chemical, and the biological properties. So in summary, this effect could be abiotic, could be also biotic, and these abiotic effects, they improve and maintain the soil structure. So the soil structure including the soil porosity, moisture, oxygen content, and the nutrient content. And this abiotic effect is a mechanical breakdown of the soil particles, and therefore release the soil, release the organic matter, and also the organic pollutants into the soil environment, and this pollutant could become bioavailable. The biological effects, they have different aspects. One is the cast and the borate lining formation. And in the cast and the borate lining, the number and of distribution of microorganisms is increased. And also during the gut passage, the soil passed through the gut. So during this gut passage, the bioavailability of the pollutants in the gut is increased because the gut has a special environment. And here the water content is higher than the normal water. And also we have biosurfactant in the gut fluid. Therefore, this biosurfactant can increase the solubility of pollutants. And here, therefore, bioavailability of pollutants will be increased in the gut. And in the gut, normally the microbial number is higher than the soil, the diversity is higher, and also the activity of the microorganisms also higher. And some bacteria which are dormant, for example, in the soil, can be awakened in the gut of the earthworms. And also, the gut of the earthworms can release small molecules. These small molecules is water soluble. They can be used by organisms as a substrate to growth, but these small molecules can be also active compound. For example, they could be enzymes, and these enzymes could do some catalytic effects. For example, they could be peroxidase, and this peroxidase can oxidize pollutants in the gut. So all of these biological effects can help earthworm to degrade pollutants. Yeah, here is also again, is the remediation effect of earthworms. So as we have already discussed, this effect could be mechanical, mechanically activity, could be biologically the promotion of some microorganism activity. And also the last one could be the pollutants could be taken up by the organisms and accumulated in the earthworms. And these three effects could help earthworms to remove pollutants from the soil. A lot of studies have done to show that earthworms can have the effect to have an effect on the degradation and mineralization and the removal of the pollutants in the soil. For example, here some agrochemicals as a herbicide and the pesticide, including atrazine, 2,4-D, metachlor, etc., have been studied. And the second class of compound is the petrochemicals, including crude oil, petroleum oil. They have been also studied and also the polyaromatic hydrocarbons, as the PAHs, have been studied, and many other aromatic compounds, for example, the PCBs, polychlorinated biphenyls, chlorophenols, and the trinitrotoluene, etc. Have also been studied. And then recently, some so-called emerging pollutants have been studied. They are, for example, nonylphenol, tetrabisphenol A, and the PBDEs. I will give example in the next slides about the degradation of nonylphenol by earthworms. And then I would like to go to that. The second part is a lab results. So here I will introduce you two results. The first one is the digestion of the proteinaceous component of the humic substances by earthworms. And the second one is the effect of earthworms on the fate of nonylphenol in soil. So So the first one is the degradation of protein compound in the by Earthworm. Here is the proposed structure of the humic substances. So the real structure of humic substances is still unknown because its structure is too complicated. The robot can give an exact chemical structure for the humic substance. But we can see the humic substances are composed of several building blocks. And these building blocks are polyphenol building blocks, and the polysaccharide building blocks, and they have also polypeptide building blocks. So this is a major building blocks for the humic substances. And here is aromatic, actually, this aromatic compound, and they are polysaccharide and non-aromatic compound. And in the soil, these humic substances can soft on the soil minerals, while this, for example, this metal-ion bridge, via hydrogen bonding interactions, and this, because of these interactions, the humic cells can be joining adsorbed to the soil minerals, and because of the adsorption is very strong and the solubility of the humic substance is very low, and therefore the bioavailability of the humic substance also low in the soil. And yeah, here the humic substance could be enclosed in the pore of the of these minerals, and because of this physical, this is a physical protection, because they are in protected in the pore of the these minerals, and they are not bioavailable to the degraders, to the organisms, and therefore they are stabilized in the soil. And actually, we see here the polyphenols is could be not interesting for the organisms, but this peptide component, the nitrogen rich compound, and they are all composed of amino acids, and therefore here is a high energy component, and actually it's a good for, it's a good substrate for the organism in the soil, but because of the protection, the organisms are not available to get it, and therefore this peptide component, this is a polypeptide component, could be stabilized in soil. So, but when earthworm, as we see in the last slide, earthworm can break down the soil aggregates. That means you can break down this aggregate and let this soil substance available to the organisms. And in these cases, and this polypeptide could be degraded by organisms, become, they could be bioavailable, and the organism can degrade this high energy, high nutrient component. So, but if this case, we don't know, we didn't know, and therefore we did some experiments to test if earthworms are available to get this polypeptide from the humic substances. To do this test, we prepared humic substances using 14C labeling. So then here, we got two humic substances. The one humic substance is the protein part, and the protein part is radioactively labeled. And another one is the aromatic part of the humic substance labeled. So that means these two humic substances are chemically identical. So chemically identical, but they are labeled in two different components. One is a protein component, and another one is aromatic component. So using these two chemical substances, we did the experiment, did the feeding experiment. Here is the right side. Here is a soil, and with earthworms, we feed these two substances. Chemical substance is here is aromatic labeled, another one is protein labeled substance into the bottle, and then we determine the mineralization of these two compounds. So left figure is the results. So we incubated in 9 days, and then we determined the mineralization. So the blue column is the control soil. That means it's without addition of earthworms. The purple column is with the addition of earthworms. So we see get two results. The first one is here in the control soil, in the absence of the earthworms, this protein part, protein component is as a stable, the same, yeah, stable as this aromatic component. So the very few minerals, only 4% mineralized. But for the in the presence of the earthworms, this color. So we see here the protein part is strongly mineralized. When we see here is compared to this aromatic component. So here this means this earthworms can selectively mineralize or digest this protein part in the soil, the protein part of the humic substance. And this is the with white earthworms, the metaphyre guillemi is a Chinese rock earthworms. And also we did the same experiment with other earthworms, this American earthworms is also present in European, I know, and we got the same results. So here we can conclude this soil feeding earthworms. So these earthworms, they feed soil. And these soil feeding earthworms can selectively digest the peptidic component. Yeah, so here, the peptidic component. And this peptidic component actually in the humic substance are stable in the soil. You see here, they are same stable as this aromatic component. And then we answer, so this peptidic component is digested in the soil, and this they are mineralized to CO2, this only the carbon atom. And what about the nitrate, nitrogen atom? So then this hypothesis could be the peptidic component is degraded to amino acids, and this amino acids is to ammonium, and the ammonium can be in soil be oxidized to nitrate. And therefore, we determined the concentration of ammonium and nitrate in the native soil and the fresh cast and also the cast after 7 days. So here we see that really in the fresh soil, a large amount of ammonium were produced. So this ammonium should come from the peptide component of the humic substances. And also the nitrate content is up. Was also higher than the natural soil or the native soil. But after several days, the concentration of the ammonium and nitrate decreased. And ammonium decreased, but this nitrate increased slightly because this ammonium can be still degraded to nitrate. And we know that ammonium and nitrate are fertilizer for the soil. And this process and this experiment showed that the earthworms can increase the soil fertility, especially in the cast of the earthworms. So then I will show you the effects of earthworms on the fate of nonylphenol in soil. So what is nonylphenol? So nonylphenol is a chemical compound. Here is the structure, chemical structure of nonylphenol, and they are used for the synthesis of the detergents, resin, fiber, etc., widely used, especially used for the production of this detergent. This is non-ionic, it's non-ionic surfactants used in household and industry. And these surfactants, if they come into the sewage plant, sewage water treatment plant, and then they can be degraded and released the nonylphenol again. So the precursor are being released. Therefore, in the sewage water and also the sewage sludge, higher concentration of nonylphenol has been detected. And we know the sludge normally, the sludge contains a large amount of nitrogen and phosphate, and they are considered to be fertilizer. It's alternative to the chemical fertilizer, and also suggested to be used as fertilizer to lawns, to the agricultural lawns. So in this case, many the high concentration of nonylfluorine has been detected also in soil, and this could be a several ppm, the concentration of several ppm. And then we studied the degradation of the nonylfluorine soil by the earthworm. We want to see what kind of effects of earthworm on the nonylfluorine fate in the soil. We did the same experiment as with the humic substances, and we put this radioactively labeled nonylfluorine, is the ring labeled, put this radioactive nonylfluorine into the soil and put earthworm to the soil, and then determine the mineralization. So the right figure is the results. We see here in the presence of the earthworm, we see here the mineralization of earthworm, mineralization of the nonylfluorine, sorry, is decreased. So the earthworm reduces the mineralization of the nonylfluorine in soil. So this could mean, okay, it's not a good for the nonylfluorine removal in the soil. But when we analyze the residues of nonylfluorine in soil, we get this results. It's the left side. So this blue one is a control soil. That means without the addition of earthworm. And the red one is the soil with earthworms. So we see here is the presence of the earthworms. The residual nonylfluorine concentration in the soil is lower than in the control soil. This is one. And another one is also the metabolites. So we got several metabolites of nonylfluorine in the soil. So this metabolite one is concentration is very high. And then this metabolite chemical structure is this nitrate nonylfluorine. So this metabolite concentration in the soil is also the concentration is also lower in the soil with earthworms. Sorry, with earthworms than in the control soil. So this means this earthworm, this earthworms, yeah, increase the removal of the nonylfluorine from soil because the concentration is lower, and also they decrease the formation of this metabolites. And this the concentration of this metabolites is lower. And this is a good thing because firstly, it's the concentration of parent compound is lower. The secondly, the metabolite is also lower. And this is good because this metabolite could be more toxic than the parent compound nonylfluorine. Since here is a nitrate group on the aromatic ring, normally is toxic symbol. And then we also analyze the boundary residues of the nonylfluorine in the soil. Boundary residues is the residue that could not be extracted from the soil, could be extracted by, soil, for example, by organic solvents. So it could not be extracted and remained as non-extractable residues in the soil. And here we analyze what kind of boundary residues are present in the soil. Normally, the boundary residues could be present in soil in two forms. One is a physical, is by a physical enclosure. That means it's present in the pore of the minerals or in the pore of the humic substance. They are physically included in the soil component. And another form for the boundary residues in soil is chemical binding of the metabolized to the soil organic matter. So we analyze the this chemical binding in the presence of the earthworm, the chemical binding residues are higher than in the control soil. So this means this residues is stable. The chemically binding residue is stable than the physically binding. And here is more chemical binding, that means by the feeding activity of the earthworms increase the stability of the boundary residues in soil. So this is a good thing for the removal, of the nonylfluorine toxicity. So then we studied the distribution of the chemically binding residues in the humic substance. So we got the, we see on which molecules are the residues bound. So we did with the GPC, geopermeation chromatography to analyze the molecular size distribution. So the blue line is the molecular size distribution of the humic substances. So this one. And the red one is the molecular size distribution of the residues from nonylphenol. And this residue should be chemically bound to the humic substances. Because these two lines are not identical, so that means this residues are not identically bound to molecules of the humic substances. And these residues are peripherally bound to the high molecular weight of the humic substance. So because here the left side is 100 kDa and the right red side is 0.1 kDa. So the left side is a high molecular weight compounds. So this to bond to the large molecules of the humic sense is more stable than bond to small molecules. Then we analyze the nonylphenol residues in the earthworm body. So we see the continually accumulation of the nonylphenol residues in the earthworm body. So here is the continuum and this BSAF, the bioaccumulation factor increase. And when we studied the present form of the residues in soil, we found that most of the residues in the earthworm body were present in bound residue form. So here is this the percentage of the bound residues to the total residues in the earthworm body. So we see here is almost 0.7. This is 70% of these accumulated residues in earthworms are bound to earthworm tissues. So they are not extractable. And this could be only available using this 14C labeling study. So if the experiment are not performed with 14C labeling, then we could not get this result. So here, many of the residues from the nonylphenol are present earthworms in the form of bond residues. And this bond residue could be very important for the risk assessment, because when the earthworms are died, then this the bond could be released again to the soil, and we don't know what happened with this bond residues. So here is a short summary about the effects of earthworm on the fate of nonylphenol in soil. Yes, nonylphenol in the soil could be metabolized and then mineralized to CO2, and part of them is nonylphenol are not degraded, and they are residual nonylphenol in the soil. And this metabolized could be active, and then they reacted with chemically react with the soil humic substance and get bound residues, this chemically bonded residues. It's in the, this is a fate of nonylphenol in soil in the absence of earthworms. And in the presence of the earthworms, then this we get this effect. The residual nonylphenol amount decreased, the metabolites amount decreased, and the CO2 amount decreased. It's logic. And this chemical binding amount increased. And also we observed a large amount accumulation of these nonylphenol residues in earthworm. So here we see here earthworm has effect on the fate of earthworm by different kind of ways. So when it's good to see that we know here earthworm can help to remove pollutants, at least the nonylphenol from the soil. And then we have evidence that earthworm can be used for soil remediation. And how to use the earthworms for the bioremediation, for the soil remediation? There are three possibilities. The first one is use direct application of earthworm to soil. Just put earthworm to soil and let earthworm to feeding the soil and then degrade or the accumulate the pollutants. The second one is co-application of the earthworm with other earthworms, yeah, together with other organisms, not earthworms, sorry. This is kind of biosimulation. So we put earthworms with other organisms, including plants with microorganisms together to the soil to increase the remediation efficiency. And also could be used, let's use the digested materials by the earthworm. For example, use a castor, not the earthworms themselves, but the castor of earthworm to the soil to finish, to do the bioremediation. So then in the third part, I'll give you some, give one example of the utilization of earthworms for the bioremediation in the field in situ. So we know in the last century in China, but now still in some Asia country, we have this disease, the schistosomiasis problem in China. And the schistosomiasis is the disease, the second most socioeconomically devastating parasite disease after malaria. And in China here is the red color is very strong, is problem, it's very problem, and here is no problem. And in China is here, we have still some area has this problem. And this schistosomiasis is caused because of one parasite, and this parasite needs the fresh snails, yes, to multiply. And here, for example, is one egg of the one egg of this parasite getting in the snails and multiply in the snail very quickly, and then this small larvae it crest to the fresh water, and these larvae can get in the animal body, people, and also eat animals very quickly in several seconds by getting into the body, and then the people has problem here. Now the people, if they are infected by this disease, it looks like this one. They have also very big abundance. So to against these snails, the problem against this disease, the in China has a company in the last century in the 1950s to cure the snails in the fresh water. So all of the people, almost all of the people in China go outside in the field to contain the snails, to cure the snails. And now in some area, we have also some problem. For example, this is the picture in 2010. We have some area also this problem, this small school kids with outside to connect the snails. And chemically, we can use these chemicals to treat this, to cure these snails. This is a pentachlorophenol. So this new here is the phenol, this hydroxy group, and these are five chloro atoms. And they are largely used in China in the last century, in this decade, to cure the snails in all of China, especially in the South China, and the concentration of this pentachlorophenol is a pond in the sediment in the soil is very, very high. And we used the earthworm to treat this pentachlorophenol contaminated soil in situ. So the earthworm is indigenous earthworms is a metaphyogonomy that I have already shown you. And also we combined these earthworms with the willow plant together to increase the remediation process, the effect. It's a willow plant. Then we did this experiment in the field. Here we put this contaminated pentachlorophenol contaminated soil. We put the willow plant in the soil and we put the earthworms in the soil and we put also the microorganisms in the soil. And here is the results after 45 days. See, this black line is a control. So it's a soil without earthworm, without the growth of plants, yeah, just the control soil. So here is the red line is we put a earthworm to the soil. It's here is 1 square meter, 80 individual earthworms. And this treatment that we put a straw to the soil to increase the soil organic carbon content, to increase the earthworm, so to give some stuff for the earthworm living. So we see here the degradation happens, and the earthworm has really some effects on the removal of pentachlorophenol. Here is the combined effect of these different kind of organisms for the removal. And here this again is control treatment. And here is the treatment with willow plants. So only the willow plants can remove this pentachlorophenol. So this is a phytoremediation because of the plants. And here is the willow and earthworm combined effect. So here you see here the both of the organisms has a combined effect and increased the removal efficiency. And this is the in the presence of the willow, earthworm, and the fungi. So we put also fungi to the soil to increase the removal efficiency. And we see here, really the removal fate is quicker it's than without the fungi addition. So now I would like to give you a conclusion. So because of this biotic and abiotic improvements by the earthworms, the earthworm may be applied to in situ bioremediation of soil with contamination of phenols, or here is especially the chlorophenols. And it could be also possible to for the remediation of other pollutants. This is a question here, but we believe we can earthworm can also do some remediation. And for this earthworm remediation, of course, we need the plants and earthworms and the microorganisms. And here the biomass of the organisms, the biomass of the plants and earthworms should be very important for the removal efficiency. So large plants could be better than a small plant. And also large earthworms could also be better than small earthworms. And actually, there is some large earthworms in the world. For example, here is the giant earthworms, which are present in Australia, Gippsland. This earthworm is very quick. This 3 meter can be here, so this one, and another one is here, is 3 meter long. So if it's possible to use this earthworm to do this remediation, then I think this could be very efficient than to use the small earthworms. So now I come to the acknowledgments. I think my PhD students, the former PhD students, Shan Jun, Li Jiahua, and also Professor Hong Yang Guo. And this study is supported by the Chinese Ministry of Science and Technology and also the National Science Foundation of China. And then thank you for your listening. And then questions and comments are welcome.
Okay, well, thank you very much, Ron. That was an excellent presentation. And as Ron said, I'm sure he'd be happy to answer any questions that people would have.
Yeah, of course.
Maybe I could start. Early on in your talk, you showed the biodiversity and also the biomass of the soil organisms in different kinds of soils. And in the annual crops, it was quite low. Mm-hmm. And so my question is, if you use like no-till agriculture, would you have a better biomass than if you had used traditional agriculture?
Yeah, it's a good question. So here, I mean, here, it's annual crops, it's a very small biomass, and the pasture is higher than that. Yeah. So this means this could be, for example, in this pasture, because of the large amount of the earthworms, so this remediation would be faster than in this crop land. But we did not compare this. Yeah, this is just a hypothesis. So in this pasture, because the biomass is higher, and also here is the earthworm's biomass also higher, and completely the whole biomass also higher. So that means here the microbes activity could be higher than in the annual crop land. And we hope this removal rate should be higher.
I think we might have a question coming in from Michael Muir. Just says, hi there.
Yeah, can I see this? Here.
I guess it's just, he's just giving us a greeting at the moment.
Yeah, I do have two questions, please, Professor Rong. Thank you very much for your talk. You have shown that you have strong accumulation of your NP in earthworm. Is there any risk of bioamplification in the food webs?
Yeah. Very good questions. So we see the accumulation of nonylphenol in earthworms is very strong, and most of the accumulated residues are bonded residues. So this bonded residue means they are always bonded to the earthworms.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And it's not excreted again by the earthworm to the soil.
Yeah.
So in this case, yeah, if some board, for example, feed it, this earthworm, then the boundary residue could be come into the board. Yeah? And in this case, the boundary residues can be released. Can be released again in the board guard, in the board guard, or the moor guard. And it could be a risk to the board. And then if other animals to eat this board, and then this residue could be transfer from the board again to the higher level predator. So this kind of risk is one kind of risk. Another kind of risk could be when the earthworm died, and then the residues will be released into the soil, and then it could be a risk to the soil environment. But this risk is still unknown, and we have to check this risk. It's a very good question.
Thank you.
Are doing something to experiment with this on the residues. Very good.
Yeah, I have to have a second question about if you try to bring the giant earthworms in China, that could be a risk as well of invasive species as well, right?
Yeah, correct. I don't want to bring it to China. I just, it would be an idea that, for example, can be used in Australia, for example, to use China. This also, I think they could not live in the Chinese environment,
Chinese soil conditions.
Yeah. Yeah.
Sorry. Thank you.
Yeah. I see we have a question on the chat from Michael Muir. I'll just read it out. So he thanks you for your talk, and he wonders how you measured the C14 concentration in your chromatography experiment. And what was the approximate C14 concentration in the eluting organic matter?
Okay, I could come to. So it's here. So how did I mirror the concentration, 14C concentration? Yeah, is this? So this, we have the detector. It's a radioactive online detector. So this is a HPLC system. We inject the samples to the HPLC column, elute it, and then firstly through this UV detector, and then through this the radioactive online detector. So then we have this UV signal and then this radioactive signal. So this is kind of the hour that we used.
That's a very clever system.
It was one question or the two question?
I think it was just, what was the concentration of C14 or the activity?
Yeah, this is activity concentration. We use the online radio detector.
So Michael wants to know whether your analyzer is specific for C14 or can it be used for other I'm assuming it's a gamma, just a beta counter, like a Geiger counter?
Mm-hmm. it's not a Gaia counter, it's a beta counter. So okay. It's also possible, for example, if you don't have the online radio detector, then you can collect the effluents, then detect and put this on the liquid scintillation counter, it's a beta counter to get this 14C signal. But it's a very, it's a hard working. You have to collect the fractions.
Yeah. Do we have other questions?
Or maybe a question for me. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Thank you for your nice talk. I was enjoying it. My question is, do you know about the mechanism of the non-new phenol degradation? Is it microbial? Is it reductive dechlorination? Can you comment on that?
The degradation of non-new phenol in soil.
Not the non-new soil was wrong. Pentachlorophenol.
Pentachlorophenol. We did not check the metabolites because in the literature there are many studies already. They say the pentachlorophenol could be reductively dechlorinated to tetra, tri, di, and monochlorophenol, and they can be also ring cleavage. Yeah, can be created on the ring to CO2. As many different possibilities.
But so you need anaerobic conditions, right? So you would need anaerobic conditions. You would anaerobic conditions.
Yeah. Under anaerobic conditions to be reductively for sure. But some studies reported on the oxygen conditions. On the oxygen conditions, it could be also reductively dechlorinated.
Okay.
It's also possible on the oxygen. Yeah. But we did not check this.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Ron, I don't know whether you can see, but we have a question in the chat from Jesus Diaz Sanas.
No, I just see four pictures from you.
Okay, I'll read the question. Yeah. And it's a similar question to one that Hui Dang asked, and that is, with the nonylphenol that was accumulated in the tissue, about the risk of food chain bioaccumulation if you're using this in on-site bioremediation.
On-site bioremediation?
So if you had a nonylphenol contaminated site and you want to use this for remediation, what's the risk of bioaccumulation in the food chain?
Okay, I see. Yeah, this is also, again, this is a good question. We still don't know the risk of the bonded residues. So it's also the next plan that we want to study, the fate of these bonded residues in soil. So if the earthworm died, we want to see if the earthworm died, then what kind of metabolites are released. They are still in the aromatic form, so it's an aromatic metabolite, or it's already broken down of some aromatic, just present as, for example, as protein or the DNA form, for example. We don't know now. We want to do the experiment.
Okay. I think I've lost your connection, maybe. Not sure whether I've lost my thing or my connection or whether we've lost Ron.
I still hear you, so I think we are losing Professor G.
Okay. Well, we'll see if we get him back. While we're waiting to maybe have him reestablish his connection, I'll just remind everybody that these lectures are being put on our website. And so if you have... that's okay. We lost you there for a minute.
Yeah, I think it's the problem with my internet connection.
Yes. Yeah. Okay. If there are there any other questions for Professor G? If not, I just want to thank you, Ron, for your excellent talk. Again, you seem to be frozen, so I'm not sure whether you can hear me or not. But also, I want to remind everyone that these lectures are being put on our website. And so if you have missed any of the lectures that have been given, you're more than welcome to go to the website. It's iiies.com. And you can find the lectures there and listen to them at your leisure. And also to let you know that next week's talk will be given by Professor Huan Zhong at Nanjing University. That's okay.
Sorry.
I'm just thanking you for your talk. And tell everybody about the talk for next week, which will be your colleague, Huan Zhong at Nanjing University, who's going to be doing a talk on mercury dynamics in rice paddies and possible remediation techniques for the mercury contamination. So any final questions for Ron? Otherwise, we'll sign off.
Yeah, you can also send me email if you have questions.
Yes, of course. Please feel free to email Ron if you have any questions. And you can find his email, I think, on our website. He's listed as one of the IIES participants. And for anybody who wants to stay on the line, Hui Dang will be on the line for some time, and we can have a continued discussion. So thank you again, Ron. Appreciate your wonderful talk.
Thank you, Doc, for this wonderful interview.
Okay. Bye, everybody.
Bye-bye. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you very much.
Bye-bye.